What is good in naturalism? This is the title of my talk. And first I tried to make a definition of naturalism. And from the very definition, I had a problem because the ontological or ontological definition of naturalism is that everything is coming from almost nothing. What is primary matter, which changes according to a mindless, reasonless, lifeless necessity and chance. Necessity is not necessary. Maybe chance only. And this is a sort of almost nothing from which materialism or naturalism, I do not make any difference between them, start as a primary substance. And from this point, I already have a problem at the level of definition, because the matter, as we know, as the physics knows it, matter follows not just some mindless, reasonless necessity. It follows mathematically beautiful and very reasonable, symmetrical, discoverable, etc., very special laws of nature. So it's not at all some sort of dark, mindless, who knows what necessity or even chance. They cannot be reduced to something mindless, because they are very intellectual, and they cannot be reduced to chance by the very same reason. So from the very definition of materialism, we see that the matter, as physics knows it, is already very intellectual thing, because it follows beautiful, symmetrical, discoverable, very precise, universal, and in a sense amazing, because humanity is amazed considering the laws of nature, how interesting they are. So this, at the very beginning of my attempt to give a definition of naturalism or materialism, I had a problem because I do not know how to define it. And if somebody will ask, well, go to Wikipedia or whatever, or some Britannica or any source of common knowledge and see the definition of materialism and naturalism. And what is written there, I did this, of course. What, for instance, I went to Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy, and what the first sentence at the article of naturalism is, the term naturalism has no very precise meaning in contemporary philosophy. Okay, so I read my own definition of materialism. Hopefully that the materialist, naturalist would agree or will reasonably correct me. So the primary substance is almost nothing, this primary matter, which follows some mindless necessity and chance. And then mindless necessity somehow transforms into mindful, something very mindful, mathematically elegant and anthropic laws. Anthropic is a term which is commonly used now. It means that the laws of nature are compatible with appearance of life, and not only life, but thinking beings like us, with so high power of thought that able to discover, for instance, these very laws. So this is very special laws. And this very special laws somehow appear or emerge on this and substitute this dark necessity. Then step by step, new essences emerge one after another. So life somehow emerges from matter, fully because of laws and chance, again, without any special reason. It just emerges. This magical word of naturalists, emergence. Why it is there? Why the laws are so mathematically beautiful? They emerge. Why the life is so sophisticated and so beautiful and so orchestrated, I would say. At the level of organism or at the level of ecosphere, just emerge. Then in the same magical way, mind emerges, and mind emerging at the very low level, able to recognize and to solve simplistic problems of life, then emerges to even higher level, up to the ability to understand the whole universe. Again, why is it possible? The answer which naturalists are given, emerge. Maybe after 1,000 years, science will discover this. Now, let's take it as a fact, or as Jim used it, just so story. It emerges. Okay, so level after level, we see that at the many level of complexity of the world, which we know, every level is described from the previous, more simple, more poor level, as a reasonless, groundless emergence. So naturalism can be described as a worldview with a sequence of groundless, reasonless emergence of something out of something lower and simpler due to chance. So its cosmogenesis can be called chaosogenesis. It goes from the simplest essence, as you may think, as close to nothing as possible, which can be called chaos, using old ancient word. So chaosogenesis, that's genesis, naturalistic genesis, how I describe it. I call it, you have, your genesis is actually chaosogenesis. Okay, so the opposition to naturalism is theism. According to theism, and I'm using theism not in the meaning of biblical theism or some Platonic theism, I'm using very general philosophical idea of theism, where everything appears of something the most powerful, the most rich essence, as rich and grand and powerful as possible, which we call God, or Plato called it the good, or Plotinus called it the one, or the one, the good, or Parmenides called it being, Spinoza called it substance, or natura naturans. There are many words which are used for the same essence, for the same terminus of being, which means the most powerful, the richest essence as possible to think, or even more rich. So it is opposition. When naturalism considers this primary substance as the poorest, almost nothing, this primary matter, theism takes the opposite side. It takes the most powerful being, this all good, and unity, the good per se, or unity of all good, as an essence and of everything. So let me stress that in both cases, both in naturalism and theism, the world is not explained in a sense that we know how life appeared. We know how thought appeared. We know where creativity of human being is coming from. In all the cases, there is no explanation. But in theism, it is mystery and reason. Because when I am saying that I don't know how this book was possible to write, but I know that this book did not pop out from nothing. There is an author, and I know that my friend Alexei Tsvelik published recently this book. This is a reasonable explanation of appearance of this book, although in a part mysterious, because I don't know how he was able to get all those interesting ideas which he implemented in this book. So mystery and reason are accompanying creativity. In naturalism, we see violation of the principle of sufficient reason, which is the foundation, the core of rationality, violation at every step, at the step of laws of nature, at the step of life, at the step of thought, at the step of rational thought. In all these levels, in the step of civilization, you may add if you want, in all the levels, everything just pops from nothing or from the poorer level where you did not find any trace of this, like you cannot find any trace of creative human being closer to Big Bang, in this mix of elementary particles. It just pops up. It just so story, as Jim said, just so story. It just appears, just emerges. So it is, let's be clear, it is a strict, consecutive violation of the principle of sufficient reason at every important step. So it is absolutely irrational worldview. It is absurdic worldview. It is as absurdic as possible. I think you cannot imagine more absurdic story of appearance of everything as naturalism or materialism. Is a champion of absurdity, I would say. So, and again, I'm not saying that theism explains this, but the theism makes it reasonable, makes it thinkable. It goes along this principle of sufficient reason. So that is why, it's no surprise, the principle of sufficient reason, first formulated by Leibniz, but it was implicitly used from the very beginning. You may find it in Plato dialogues, etc. I know the history of humanity, although Leibniz reflected on that and formulated this. Leibniz was theist, of course. For Leibniz, Leibniz proved the God existence followed by the principle of sufficient reason. So if the world is reasonable, then God must exist. This was a line of sort of Leibniz. So principle of sufficient reason leads you to God and makes the existence of God necessary. And this is actually was not even from Leibniz. You may find it in different ways formulated in ancient philosophy, in Plato, even in that famous definition of Anselm from Canterbury, definition of God, and the God existence follows from the definition. Again, it is the same idea, although misinterpreted time to time. But the idea essentially of Anselm is the same. So this is definition of naturalism and definition of theism. It's a position, and in theism, everything is follows from this terminus, which is all good, goodness per se, and step by step everything is created, and at the end of this creation line, thinking beings like us are created, and there is a purpose of creation. The purpose is to increase our, at least what concerns to us, increase our communion with our Creator. This is theistic worldview, not only Biblistic, also you may find it in Plato. Communion, and also in Indian wisdom you may find this, in Advaita Vedanta, for instance. Thus, theistic being is a loop. So everything is going from the most powerful source, and then the purpose is to return to this source, to make as powerful communion with this source as possible. So this is a loop, but the loop where something increases, something very powerful and important appears and realizes its potential. Okay, so what is good in naturalism is the title of my talk. What is reasonable and good in very general sense, reasonable, it can, about truth. What is inspirational in naturalism? I would say it's about beauty. And what is morally encouraging in naturalism? About laws of nature, I already said, and I may address to our papers with Lev, who unfortunately is not here today, pythagoreanuniverse.com, our website, where you may read our couple of essays. I made many talks, actually, in this society. You may go and find my talks about unreasonableness to assume the primacy of matter, which I already actually said today. So naturalism is unreasonable at each point, which I already said, I think. Why naturalism is fundamentally evil? Now my point is about morality. From morality point of view, my statement is naturalism is fundamentally evil. Why it is fundamentally evil? Because it leads to nihilism or moral relativism. There is no moral truth. You may find, according to naturalism, some truth about nature, measuring something and stating some facts about natural world, or checking some theories, even theoretical truth is possible, but moral truth is not. There is no moral truth when you measure natural things. If somebody will tell, well, moral truth is the idea of survival of humanity. Well, why should I sacrifice something for survival of humanity, I will ask. You, if you want, you may sacrifice whatever you want for survival of humanity or for better life of humanity. Why should I? No answer. The only answer is if you don't want, we will force you to do it. But okay, this is already language of force, of power. It's not a language of reason. It's completely different language. They do not have an answer. And this makes the teaching fundamentally evil. Because if we don't have a reason to believe in the moral truth, then whatever is possible. Only the power of force is ultimate argument. And then all the flowers of evil are blooming in this terrible field. And you may think, about, it's not exaggeration, as 20th century showed to us, because German Nazism was built essentially on social Darwinism. It was one of the variations of social Darwinism. And Hitler was social Darwinist, very consistent. Marxism, which is even more evil, maybe, theory than Nazism, is built on a sort of mechanistic naturalism of Karl Marx. So, and negation of objective truth. So these two regimes, extremely evil by their fruits, they both are flowers or fruits at this field, at the field of naturalism. And if you will consider what happens with contemporary Russia, let me give example of the country where I'm from. Contemporary Russia is a country coming out from 75 years of very severe Marxist regime, where people actually forgot what is religious worldview, and they came out of it very cynical, actually, very cynical. And contemporary Russia is very cynical country, I would tell you. And that is, although there are 70, according to statistics, 70% are Orthodox Christians, but this is very superficial. They are just following mainstream because this is party line today. Party line today is Orthodoxy. Because it's ideology to make a sort of authoritarian, semi-totalitarian state, and people are following. After all, people like to celebrate holidays, to baptize their kids, to say last words to those who passed away. They will like it, but very few people would be ready to sacrifice something for moral truth. In this respect, they are very cynical, and they are. Christianity is very, very superficial. It's not Christianity, actually, I would say even. This is sort of magical cult, superseded the Christianity, which stay on the position of Christianity. Very few people are. There are, of course, some true Christians, but their percentage is very little. Okay. So naturalism discourages people to make sacrifice for truth. And if in the society the number of people who are ready to sacrifice for moral truth, this number of people is small, then the society, even blooming and even good for today, is doomed for destruction. It will not stay long because it is good because of the previous generations who were ready to sacrifice, who sacrificed and built good institutions and insisted and developed good habits of citizens. But if this wisdom of the previous generation is lost, then people do not have a reason to defend moral truth, to sacrifice for moral truth. And step by step, the generation, the society would degrade. It would degrade to what I called a Hobbesian swamp. What is Hobbesian swamp? It's a lowest possible state of society, which is combination of war all against all, cruel tyranny, and something intermediate, war of mafia clans against mafia clans. So three basic vectors, and each one, none of them is good actually. All of them are bad. It's hard to tell. Hobbes considered that cruel tyranny is better than war of all against all. I don't know. I cannot make my choice. I think all of them are very bad. Hobbes had his own experience in the civil war in England in 17th century. It was very hard period in the history of England. And Hobbes even did not believe that something better is possible. Locke believed. And Locke, John Locke, who was a contemporary of Thomas Hobbes, he believed that English people are religious enough, are seriously religious enough to build better society. And the future shows that Locke was right. England made way better than it was in 17th century during the civil war, and which Hobbes and Locke also observed. But Locke was optimist, and this is maybe a rare case in the history of humanity when optimistic point of view showed that it is true. Okay, so fundamentally evil. When naturalism is fundamentally depressive, so from the point of view of art, let me be limited by European. European art is permeated by religious inspiration. Paintings, beautiful temples, sculpture, music, if you will see at the core of it, is religious inspiration. So it's many, it's blooming world of religious inspiration, of beauty generated by religious motifs. Well, naturalism or materialism is not new. It was known at least from the classical antiquity. Do we know any example of beautiful picture, of beautiful music, which author will tell, I was inspired by materialism and naturalism, and I wrote even, none of them, none. Sometimes, if you will see the buildings which were built materialistic, naturalistic architects, they essentially, mostly, they are dull. They are constructivist, simplistic shape, more proper to be prison than places. Not this one. This is better. I like our lambda shape of this building. And I don't see Bob Wilson was materialist. So, okay. So, it is depressive from the point of view of art. It is depressive from the point of view of life. So, you may read more details in psychology, in the article of psychologist Clay Routledge. This is Scientific American article. To feel meaningful is to feel immortal. In naturalism, you cannot feel immortal. Everything is mortal. So life is intrinsically meaningless. And to feel meaningless is maybe the worst which may happen with a person. If somebody feels meaningless, how can I care my life? How can I care life about other people? In this paper, this is a paper of psychologist, field psychologist who makes measurements, statistics, etc., and with a lot of references, which I'm happy to address with many details. Number of percentage of suicides is way higher among naturalists materialists than among religious people. Accidents, life expectancy. Mental and physical health, everything goes down according to this paper, according to statistics. So now I finished with a recollection of what I said last time. What do naturalists answer on that sort of criticism? This criticism also, not you, I just collected whatever I heard, or maybe I did a little bit from myself. So, for instance, about loss of nature. Sean Carroll, one of the most outspoken, wide-spoken naturalist physicist, professor of physics of, I don't remember which university of American. He called himself poetic naturalist. And Jim actually quoted him, Sean Carroll. In his book, which he recently published, he did not even touch, this professor of physics, he did not even touch the question of why the laws are what they are. He's just avoiding this question. When he was asked this query question in one of the interviews, he answered, we do not know why the laws are what they are. Maybe string theory or some other theory will explain it in 1,000 years. Let's continue this discussion after 1,000 years. Okay, but before taking his invitation to come back to 1,000 years and discuss this issue again, it would be good to remind him that string theory, even if it will prove or something similar to this, it will be proven that it plays a role sort of theory of everything, it's still mathematically elegant theory. The question would be then, why string theory takes place? Why this mathematically elegant theory has such a power in the being? Or as Hawking formulated it famously, who put the fire in these equations? Hawking once asked, well, let's imagine that we build the theory of everything. We explain all the laws of nature from some beautiful theory. But beautiful theory, whatever it is, after all, is just equations. What power brings the fire in this equation, made the universe for it? Why this equation did not continue to be just one set of possible equations? Why they are implemented in the universe? So Sean Carroll does not answer this question. And by the way, Stephen Hawking, he was a very strange person, actually. He normally is considered, he called himself atheist, and he indeed made many atheistic statements, but he made also other anti-atheistic statement, I would say, theistic statement. Once he asked himself a question publicly, why the laws are what they are? And assuming that they are discoverable, they are mathematically elegant, etc. He assumed all of this. And well, he said, one of the explanations is that God, who created the universe, wanted the laws to be discoverable. That is why he used the discoverable laws. He said, one of the possible explanations. Did Stephen Hawking suggest at least one more possible explanation? Never. Did anybody else suggest at least one more possible explanation? I do not know. I consider myself, by the way, an expert in this field. I even got an award for my SF in this very field. I did not see, I read a lot in this, and I did not see a single possible explanation. I am not saying proved explanation, just reasonable, possible, reasonably possible. No, there is only one reasonably possible explanation formulated brilliantly by Stephen Hawking, I don't know, maybe 20 years ago or so. That God wanted the laws of nature to be discoverable by people, by thinking beings who will appear in this very universe. Sean Carroll and people like him, like prophets of nature, and they disregard this sort of question. Or saying this nonsense that maybe string theory will explain come after 1,000 years. It is nonsense. It's not an explanation. So one more point, do naturalists answer? We do not know why and how life appeared, about life, and how life appeared, and know very little why and how it evolved. Maybe an infinite multiverse is an explanation. Again, come after 1,000 years and we will discuss again with a new shed of light from the new science. well, it's come after 1,000 years, it repeats again. It's new sort of argument, I think, invented by Sean Carroll. I think that one more weaseling out of the question or trolling or whatever it is. But this does not take into account that life is very sophisticated. And how is it possible that the very idea that life may appear by itself, just popping out of dead matter or just simple non-live matter, this idea again is a contradiction to principle of sufficient reason. They disregard it. We believe that people about morality. We believe that people are good or will be good enough, ethical enough, without God. In any case, we cannot believe in God purely on the ethical basis. So there are actually two statements here. So naturalists normally, and actually this is similar to socialists, or old-style socialists of the 19th century or even 18th century, that people are good, but society is bad, somehow. Why society is bad when people are good? It's one more mystery of naturalists or socialists, leftist people. So people are good. So they do not need God. But again, these people who are saying this, they disregard that mass crimes of the 20th century were committed by masses, not by Stalin, for instance, or Hitler only. No. Number of people which participated in the crimes of 20th century, in gulags and Holocaust, in Auschwitz and in Colima, and many, many camps, the number of people is big portion of the population. These crimes would not be possible if only few evil people would possess the country, because people would not follow the crime. They would prefer sacrifice even their life, but do not kill innocent people. They prefer it to kill innocent people and to make some business on this, to make some benefit on this. Would it be in Germany or in the Soviet Union or in China or whatever? And all these regimes were atheistic. All these regimes were atheistic. And let me remind about Soviet Union and China, it is well known. But also in Germany, in 1933, this is a fact which maybe I'm not sure that many people know. In 1933, in the parliament election, in Bundestag election in Germany, three parties share it, I think, 90% of votes. It is a Nazi party, a social Darwinistic party, essentially atheistic, naturalistic party. It is a social democratic party, which despises religion. Well, they adopted it. They were not military atheists, but they despise it. And communist, military atheists. So three atheistic party got 90% of votes in the Bundestag. This was the situation in Germany. So it's not only about Hitler. The soil was already prepared for this flowers of evil to bloom. The soil was prepared very well, not only in Soviet Union or Soviet Russia at that time, but in Germany, similar. So that's about how good are people by themselves. And from this point of view, I think it is much more sober, the idea of Christianity, that humans are fallen creatures, that we have in ourselves the seed of fall. We are inclined to very bad things. And when you are living in a good condition, like in this country, for instance, on the, in the West, contemporary West today, you may easily forget it. But this is, we are enjoying actually by society, which is built by religious faith of previous generations. Otherwise, we would have in everywhere Hobbesian swamp, tyranny, combination of tyranny, war all against all, and war of mafia clans. Because nobody wants to sacrifice something for the sake of moral truth, because nobody believes in moral truth. Nobody believes that moral truth, maybe it does exist somewhere, but why should I sacrifice for it? In this case, you would not find even a single just judge. Because to be just judge, the judge should sacrifice, put his life under the risk to make a just conviction, because judge is always under pressure, always under pressure. And if you will not find a single person who would be able to sacrifice or to put his life and life of his family, by the way, it's significant risk pronouncing just conviction, the society would be Hobbesian swamp, nothing else. Okay, so that's about people are good. We cannot believe in God in any case, we cannot believe in God purely on ethical basis. Well, there are many basis, which there are many roads which leads actually to conclusion that there is a super powerful source of being. And ethical argument is only one of them. Argument from the laws of nature, argument from life, it's other arguments. But even if imagine that we are not so sure about other arguments, even if to take the ethical arguments only, why they're despising this argument? Why they throw it? Well, we cannot believe in God on this argument. Why? It's very powerful, very important argument. This argument of life and death, after all. If you understand what is on the stake. It's argument on the life and death. And if you continue blah, blah, blah with your naturalism, you are bringing here and there seeds of evil. What you are doing? Do you understand it or not? That's what actually happens with naturalism. They are not able to believe in God on the ethical ground. Ethical ground is very important. We cannot believe in God because of abundant meaningless suffering. This is actually a very powerful argument, but even this argument is actually weak. Because theism assumes afterlife. This is important part of all developed theistic doctrines. And this, by the way, is the distinction between theism and deism. Deism is, from this point of view, deism is poor doctrine. But all classical theistic doctrines, they assume afterlife. And you do not know the meaning of suffering unless you will take into account the afterlife. And people who suffer it, innocent people, good people suffer it in this world. They're coming to God. And God hugs them and thanks them for their service to him. And for instance, I consider it as very meaningful, very inspirational idea to suffer in this world and then come after life and be thanked by my Heavenly Father. So thank you so much, my dear son, that you helped me a lot when you took the burden of this suffering and did your best. I think it is a very inspirational idea. We don't know why one or another person is suffering. But if we don't trust God, everything would be meaningless. If we trust God, We can accept it and took this burden on our shoulders and do our best to be co-authors of this world. Because whenever we are taking the suffering and pain in our shoulders and trying to do our best, we are becoming really co-authors of this world. And this is very inspirational, very meaningful idea. So I think the suffering, the argument of suffering, should be reversed. The argument of suffering is an argument of divinity and of importance of and hardness of what is expected from us. And important can be only those things which are hard, actually. Things which are easy and do not require any significant sacrifice from us cannot be meaningful, cannot be important. They can make us happy to enjoy the life, but it would be very lightheaded. The real meaning and importance and value is always associated with suffering. And everybody who had children in their family knows that it's very hard to raise children. And at the same time, it is very important to do your best in raising them. And you know in the depths of your heart how important it is, how valuable it is. And when you are finishing your life and trying to think, what good I did in this life, if you really did your best to grow up your children, I think it is a good idea to say farewell to this world with this idea in mind. Well, maybe I did many mistakes, but at least I tried my best and did not so bad job with raising my children. And again, it is so because it's very hard and requires a lot of suffering. A lot of suffering. Okay, so the argument of suffering is actually not anti-theistic, it's a theistic argument. We do not believe in God because of the regression problem. Who created God? Well, with the matter, we had principle sufficient reason disturbing every point. With theism, the very idea of terminus, of the unity of all good, is built in this way that all deep thinkers were satisfied by the logical structure of this terminus. The terminus could be only unity of all good. This is conclusion of many different deep thinkers coming again and again to this terminus, expressing in different words by the same idea. Say from Parmenides, Heraclitus, Plato, and Plotinus, Aristotle, Anselm, Descartes, etc., etc. Spinoza, Leibniz, they, with many differences between these thinkers, they agreed in this terminus, all good. So theism is a system of vision where the problem of terminus is logically, consistently solved. It doesn't mean that it explains again the world. There are a lot of mysteries in the world. We do not know many things. Maybe humanity will never know many things. But reason is not despised. Reason is satisfied. One more statement. I cannot believe in God because I hate this idea. I do not want God to exist. This is a statement of Thomas Nagel, famous philosopher, and I appreciate this statement because Thomas Nagel is saying that I dare to confess this. But many people who actually agree and imply in their thinking this idea, they would never confess. And I think it is a great of Thomas Nagel. This is an already old man. Like I think he is close to 90, professor of philosophy. From his book, The Last Word. And he's saying that this is very, very common hatred of the idea of the God existing. I do not want for God to exist. That is why I do not agree with theism. I will never agree with this. I think this is a powerful statement that we should not consider it the idiosyncrasy of Thomas Nagel, a very strange feature of his character. At least he is insisting that it is very common. And I think his observation has a certain ground. He is, after all, he is a rather wise man, Thomas Nagel. Oh. Okay.
Skip five.
Huh?
Skip five. Skip number five. Oh, he talked about that before, I think.
It was a previous half hour.
Yeah. Yeah. So now I have some comments to Jim's statements. So God, dualism, etc. would all be fine. This is Jim. Yellow, in yellow are Jim's statements. God's dualism, etc. would be fine if there were evidence for them and not contradiction produced by them. But observations seem pretty consistent with the natural world. So my answer, scientific observations per se tell nothing about theism versus naturalism. The problem is at the higher level of meaning and sufficient reason. At the higher level, naturalism is fully reasonless, depressing, and morally evil. That's my statement. So at the level of observation, of course, when we are measuring with our devices and per meters or whatever we are using, just regular meters. Because, okay, now I measure this table, now I measure God. No, of course, it does work. Yeah.
I also talked to Jim after the last meeting. I don't find those arguments very persuasive. I want to know what's true. That's what I want.
Yeah,
to
that's good.
I want to know what's true. You know, even if you're if there's ethical implications and all that kind of stuff, I want to know what's true.
Right, and this is good.
And that's,
me too.
That kind of goes with this first
statement. Yes, right.
That's what's true based on evidence.
Yes. The next, your philosophy should take into account progress in the physical understanding of the world and not be in conflict with observations. And my comment is exactly. And here is a point where naturalism demonstrates total failure, because laws of nature, they are discovered by physics. I think this is the most important philosophical deliverance of physics, the mathematical beauty of the laws of nature. And this is completely disregarded by naturalism. So nature disregards the most important philosophical delivery of physics. Descartes declared that God would not lie. I don't have that faith. I assume the world is ordered because I see it is ordered. Okay, my answer. This faith is a foundation of theoretical science. As Descartes actually put it. If God lying, or if we are victims of some powerful demon, or if we are victims of such wrong, completely distorted vision, fundamentally distorted vision, is there is no reason to believe that we are able to discover some laws of nature, for instance. And if we discover them, it is contradiction already to assumptions that that God can lie, or maybe that we are victim of some distorted visions. So without this belief that God does not lie, theoretical science is meaningless and valueless. By the way, there is also a value of theoretical science. What is the value of fundamental science? Fundamental science is not driven, was never driven actually by practical means. If we will consider fathers of science, from Galileo, I don't know, Einstein or Heisenberg, their discoveries were not driven by practical reasons. Never. They were driven by what Einstein called cosmic religious feeling. And if you consider that God is lying, or that matter somehow happens, that we are able to think and discover maybe how to grow up carrots in our backyard, so not, why should we believe that we are able to discover the laws of the universe? It's absolutely groundless. So Bible is not divine. One more statement of Jim. Bible is not divine revelation based on understanding of stars, etc. Yes, he made comparison of biblical statement of Genesis 1 and Big Bang theory, or theory of the first milliseconds of the universe, which we know now. And he said, for instance, that water. We know that water appeared much later, but in the Genesis we see that Spirit of God was flying underwater. So this is very, very superficial strawman argument. Because, of course, we should not. But first, I did not consider Bible, I consider theism philosophical. But even if to come to Bible, if you want to discuss what is written to Bible, you should understand the symbolic, poetical language of Bible, which was addressed at people of that time when the text actually was first maybe appeared or written somehow, which was many thousands of years ago, about Genesis 1. Why then, following this very strange strawman argument, you may say that, well, there is no general relativity in Genesis 1, so Genesis 1 is obviously wrong. That sort of language, I think, is very naive and very superficial at best. So mind-body dualism, probably not, Jim said. The limits we have on their unknown forces, possible interactions, strengths, rule them out as having sufficient interaction with our brains to have anything, brains to have anything to do with thinking. So he says that no dualism. So our thoughts are driven by chemistry of our brain. But if you will consider seriously this, that our thoughts are driven by chemistry of our brains, on what ground you will believe on the reasonability of your thoughts? You may try to explain it like this, but on what ground you will believe that you're really discovering laws of nature, not seeing some dreams or whatever? So it's very, very absurd statement, I would say. And Jim also said that, with a reference of Sean Carroll, that as far as we know, the chemistry of the brain is totally follows the laws of nature. This is just false. We do not know the chemistry of brain, and possibly we'll never know, because to see with our devices what happens within the cell of the brain, we would destroy this brain. So brain apparently does not allow us to see in very details what happens there. if you are trying to see what happens there, you will destroy the cell, because you need very powerful X-rays or electrons or whatever the particles you want. So neither naturalism nor theism suggest an explanation of the world. It's even hard to imagine how such explanations could be possible, except in very general and symbolic terms. So from this point of view, you may consider both of them non-explaining. Within each of them, there are many unknown, but possibly knowable issues, mostly related to scientific research, of course. However, the most fundamental issues are scientifically unknowable in principle in each of them. The main difference relates to these fundamental unknowables. For theism, they constitute reason and mystery, intrinsic value of meaningful ethical life, and cosmic cognition. For naturalism, they constitute the absurd and nihilism. Mystery encourages and elevates our reason and spirit. So mystery is actually a very good thing. So that's why, by the way, in this laboratory, the first floor, whenever some exhibition, you see the mystery of the universe. We're discovering the mystery of the universe. The word mystery is a religious word. It's a word from like a religious language. And it's mostly associated with what God is doing. So that is why, by the way, the word mystery is so powerful, is so inspirational. We have mystery, and mystery goes with reason. So mystery and reason are not opponents. They're actually friends. And the value of reason is one of the mysteries of this world. Value of reason is supported by the mystery of this world. But absurd is quite opposite. If something is absurd, the reason cannot be respected or believed in the world, which it's has absurd as its foundation. So the absurd does the opposite. It discourages and devaluates them. It devaluates actually all the values. So that's why the belief that the world is fundamentally goes from absurd, this chaos of genesis, this very depressive point of view. Still, some people choose the absurd, evil and depressive. Why? Thomas Nagel gave his answer, I quoted him, which he sees as the core and fundamental one. But there are other reasons, I think, why people choose depressing, absurd, and evil. I will just list them. Why? If the naturalism, materialism is so bad from all points of view, nothing good in that. Why there are many people who share this? I think it's sort of contradiction. Why? It is a very reasonable question to try to answer. I see several factors which works in this direction. Which of them is more important, which less, I don't know. I will just list them. One of them is an absolutization of scientific cognition. So Among naturalists, there are many scientists. And science is very competitive business. You have to start your involvement in science from high school and spend a lot of time to be competitive, to be a good student in university, to win the position in the good university again as a professor in the laboratory, like this, etc. It takes a lot. So people essentially spend all their time in scientific education and in scientific work. And what relates to other areas of thought, they are completely uneducated. Completely. They are barbaric totally. And exclusions are rare, actually. Exclusions are rare. And there is a reason for that, which I try to explain. And then when you are coming to the question which goes outside of science, which science is not in principle able to answer, people are starting to believe in nonsense or trying to expand methods and style of scientific cognition to the area where science is completely inapplicable. Because science has, in principle, has its borders. And for instance, physics is discovering the laws of nature. The question why the laws are what they are, metaphysical already. Because the answer, like, because of string theory, is not an answer. Because again, why is the string theory? Why not something else? So absolutization of science and hardness of scientific education and high level of competition make people actually philosophically stupid. Many scientists, even bright scientists. So that is why you should not trust even very bright scientists when he's saying about philosophy. Most likely he will say something nonsensical. This is rather typical. I'm not saying that it's always the case, but it's rather typical, and there is a big reason for that. So it's absolutization of science, which has another reason, due to success, the tremendous success of scientific cognition. People are trying again to explore science wherever it cannot be applied. So another reason, a possible riot against degraded religion. Religion may be degraded. Not all religions are good. Sometimes every religion could really degrade and be in very poor state. Some young people are rioting when they see that sort of nonsense is trying to push in their heads, they are rioting. And they are throwing the baby with the water. That's what normally are doing. Reaction to abuse in forms of religion. This is similar to the previous. Possible abuse. There are many abuses, of course, in the forms of religion, because people are still people, prone to evil things, sometimes in the mask of religion. A teenage impulse to freedom, possibly drawn out. All sort of delusional misunderstanding. Or worse, it may be driven by inner evil or shadow, if I will use a psychoanalytical term, typically under a mask of fight for freedom or something else. Nihilism opens the gates of hell, actually. And there is something in us wanting it. We should be fair about us. So we prone to evil. Normal people are prone to evil. And evil is some sort of power. Although, according to Plato philosophy, not only him, but many philosophers, negated evil as an essence. They considered evil as a deficiency of good. But from many aspects, evil shows itself as a power. And this is actually a hard philosophical problem. I think sometimes evil shows itself as an active power, like Marxist regimes or Nazi regime. Well, it's well-organized power doing very evil things. So, and there is evil in every person, this seed of evil. It just waits for the gates to be open and to start to celebrate their evil things. So if you will read some deep authors, like Dostoevsky, for instance, let me use Russians whom I know better, or those who wrote stories about Gulag, Shalamov, there is one more author who had even much worse experience than Solzhenitsyn, you will see the power of evil. You will see this hell, this goes and starts to act. And, you know, the gates of hell should be kept closed. But there is an onset from the other side. There is this onset. We should not be naive to disregard this. And whenever such sort of moral nihilistic theory with the belief that people are good is coming, well, one of the possibility that somebody from the other side of the gates of hell is talking through their mouth. It is possible. I'm not saying that it is always the case. Maybe it is rather rare case, but it is possible and very dangerous. And I would like to stop to finish my talk on, by quotation from Roger Scruton, one of my favorite philosophers, who passed away January 12th of this year. Roger Scruton, British philosopher, from his book, Face of God. He was knighted, Sir Roger. Couple of quotations related to my talk. The first one. In the religions that are familiar to us, the idea of grace is of fundamental importance. The term, Latin gratia, translates a variety of words in Hebrew, Greek, Arabic, and Sanskrit. But all our sacred texts seem to point in some direction, in the same direction, affirming that God's relation to the world as a whole and to each of us in particular is one of giving. One of giving. The idea that the world is sustained by gift is second nature to religious people who believe that they should be givers in their turn if they are to receive the gift on which they depend for their salvation. The Eucharist commemorates God's supreme gift, which is the gift of himself, his own descent into the world of suffering and guilt, in order to show through his example that there is a way out of conflict and resentment, a way to restore through grace the givenness of the world. It's, I think, very brilliant expression of the core of theism, ethical core of theism, and also ontological. And one more quotation from him. We should be about the reason of why people choose atheism. We should not be surprised, therefore, if God is so rarely encountered now. The consumer culture is one without sacrifices. Easy entertainment distracts us from our metaphysical loneliness. Metaphysical loneliness is a term which he explores in this book, Face of God. And this is a precondition to encounter God in one or another mystical way. Without metaphysical loneliness, you will be distracted from this. This is a space where God may come to you, and you may have this experience. The rearranging of the world as an object of appetite obscures its meaning as a gift. The defacing of eros and the loss of rites of passage eliminates the old conception of human life as an adventure within the community and an offering to others. It is inevitable, therefore, that moments of sacred awe should be rare among us, that because of this reason. And it is surely this, rather than the argument of the atheists, that has led to the decline of religion. Roger Scruton, Face of God, 2012, one of his brilliant books. Okay, that's all. Thank you so much.